My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power, to make known to the children of man your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. The Lord is righteous in all his ways and kind in all his works. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. He fulfills the desire of those who fear him. He also hears their cry and saves them. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord.
Take your Bibles with me today and turn to Psalm 145. Psalm 145, right about in the middle of your Bible. Psalm 145. So as we begin today, let me ask you a question, and I want you to think for just a second, all right? I know it's Sunday morning, and sometimes on Sunday morning, we don't want to think. We kind of want to sit back and let somebody else do the thinking for us. But let me ask you to think about something this morning. Very personal question. What are you thankful for? Think about that for just a second. For what are you thankful? You might even want to take just a second and write it at the top of your outline today. And I know there's a lot of things for which we are thankful, but if you had to narrow it down to one specific thing, what is it above everything else for which you would express your praise and your thanks to the Lord? Now, if we turn those papers in, and we're not going to today, if we turn those papers in and we actually saw what you wrote down or what you thought or that for which you were most thankful, I would venture to say that many of us, if not the majority of us, would mention something that God has done for us. For example, today you might have written, "I am thankful for my family." And what a great thing to be thankful for. I trust that you're thankful for your family. God has given your family to you, whether it's your wife or your husband or your kids or your grandkids. Yes, he even gave you your mother-in-law, all right? That is a gift from God to you. So maybe you wrote down, "I'm thankful for my family." Maybe you wrote down, "I'm thankful for God's provision." Maybe today you're extremely grateful for your job, or maybe you're extremely grateful for the fact that there is food in your refrigerator or a roof over your head. Maybe you're thankful today just for God's protection. Maybe at some time during the week you experienced the protection of God. Maybe there was a serious accident in front of you, or maybe you've gone through a health crisis, whatever, and you have felt God's protective hand in your life. Maybe today you're a sports fan and you're just thankful that the Miami Hurricanes fired Coach Al Golden and the Dolphins fired Coach Philbin. Maybe that's what you're thankful for today. All of those things are absolutely wonderful. And all of those things are things for which you and I should be grateful. We should be thankful. Usually, we give thanks for what God does in our lives. Rarely, though, do we pause and give thanks for who God is. As a matter of fact, we're often so focused on, excuse the directness, we're focused on ourselves so much, and we're grateful for what God is doing for me and what God is doing for you, that we fail to focus on Him. During this Thanksgiving season, and by the way, doesn't it seem weird to say that we're in the Thanksgiving season already? It seems like, June was just here, but we're the second Sunday in November already. During this Thanksgiving season, we want to pause and we want to praise God for His greatness. We want to praise God for who He is. As I mentioned in the beginning, we're going to be looking at Psalm 145, just one psalm we're going to study during 4 weeks. We're going to divide it up into four different sections, and for the next 4 weeks, we're going to study Psalm 145, and we want you to have a clear understanding of what God is saying through David to us through the psalm. Before we jump into the passage and look at it today, though, let me just give you a brief introduction to the book of Psalms. Most of us are probably familiar with the Psalms, but let me just give you a brief introduction, a few very simple facts. The first is this, and they're in your outline. The book of Psalms is the irreplaceable devotional guide, the prayer book, and the hymnal of the people of God. Now, believe it or not, you might not remember this, but there used to be a day and age in which people worshiped without great big screens. Did you know that? Did you know that there was a day in which there weren't screens and they put the words to songs up on the screens? I'm not sure whether you knew that or not, but there was a time in which people came to church and they had a hymn book, and even before they had a hymn book, they had the book of Psalms. The book of Psalms was the worship guide. It was the hymn book for the nation of Israel. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in just a few moments. But it was the actual book that the children of Israel took, and they sang these psalms or songs that you and I have in front of us today. I would go so far as to say that the book of Psalms is probably one of the most loved, one of the most read, and one of the most cherished books of the Bible. Let me just ask today, how many of you would name the book of Psalms as your favorite book in the Bible? Anyone today? You would say that the book of Psalms is your favorite book. Many people view the book of Psalms as their favorite book. There's no doubt that the book of Psalms gives comfort during times of mourning, encouragement during times of discouragement, and strength for spiritual weakness. As a matter of fact, I would encourage you to spend a lot of time in the book of Psalms. In my daily devotional reading, I read at least one psalm every single day. And there's times in my life, either when I'm discouraged, and yes, pastors get discouraged sometimes, and there's times when I need encouragement that I run to the book of Psalms, and it encourages me. The second thing that we maybe need to know is that the book of Psalms was written by a variety of Jewish authors. Sometimes people think that David wrote all of the Psalms. And David didn't write all of the Psalms. He wrote a great majority of them. As a matter of fact, he wrote just about half of them. 73 of the Psalms are attributed to David. 12 Psalms were written by a man by the name of Asaph, who was one of the musical leaders of Israel. 12 psalms were written by the sons of Korah, one by a man named Heman, one by a man named Ethan, and one by Moses. About 100 of the psalms have identified their author. The other 50 psalms are anonymous. We're not exactly sure who wrote them. The book of Psalms is divided up into 5 different books. We call it one book, but it's really divided up into 5 different books. And if you have a study Bible or even a chronological Bible in the beginning, it'll outline those 5 different books. But each of those books ends with a doxology. Each of them ends with a few verses in which they are praising God. It's interesting, there are more than 400 quotations or allusions to the Psalms in the New Testament. As a matter of fact, Jesus quoted the Psalms more than any other book of the Old Testament. Paul quotes the Psalms at least 25 times in his epistles. And so as we look at the book of Psalms, we're not just looking at a devotional guide, something that can lift us up on days when it's raining outside and we feel discouraged. No, the book of Psalms is a major theological book that points us to who God is. It's a book that teaches us how we should truly worship Him. And so I would say this, that the greatest purpose for the book of Psalms is to help us in our praise. Let me say that again, because that's really important. The greatest purpose of the book of Psalms is to help us in our praise. The book of Psalms was written for worship. As a matter of fact, the term Psalms comes from the Greek word that speaks of songs sung to the accompaniment of musical instruments. And so in other words, each of these Psalms, all 150 Psalms, were written for the purpose of being sung. So take your Bibles today. We're going to sing Psalm. No, I'm just teasing. We're not going to sing Psalm 145. We'll read Psalm 145. But the Psalm that we're studying today was written not just to be read. Most certainly, it was written to be sung as well. It's funny, I remember there's certain Psalms that I know that have music to it. I remember even when Vicki and I were dating, there were certain psalms that we would sing. Psalm 19, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimonies of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple. And there's many songs in which they have been put towards music that not only help us to praise the Lord, but they help us to memorize those psalms as well. And so today we're going to look at just the first seven verses. Follow along. I trust you have your Bibles, your iPhone, your iPad, something with you. Follow along with me. We'll put it up on the screen as we read the first seven verses today. The psalmist says this, I will extol you, my God and King. I will bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall commend your works to another, and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty, and on your wondrous works, I will meditate. They shall speak of the might of your awesome deeds, and I will declare your greatness. They shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. Would you pray with me today? Lord, this morning we pause from our busy lives for the purpose of praising you. We realize that there's only one person here today that is worthy of praise. It's you. So Lord, I pray with our hearts today, with our minds, and even with our voices, I pray that you would help us to praise you, our holy, awesome, majestic, all-powerful, incomprehensible God. We praise you today, not only for what you do for us, but this morning we praise you for who you are. And Lord, I pray that as we walk through this psalm, that praise would become a normal part of our everyday lives and help us to learn from David, who maybe understood praise more than anyone else. Help us to learn from him. And may our lives, Lord, be a song of praise to you. We promise to give you all the honor and all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Psalm 145 is one of those 73 psalms that was written by David. As a matter of fact, there's a title at the beginning of the psalm that we didn't read that simply says this, a song of praise of David. Psalm 145 is what we call an acrostic psalm. By that, each of the verses begins with a successive letter of the Hebrew alphabet. And I'm not sure whether anybody here knows Hebrew, but if you knew Hebrew and you were able to read Psalm 145 in Hebrew, each of those verses would begin with a successive letter of the Hebrew alphabet. Interestingly, and you can study this, there is one letter that is missing. It's the 13th letter in the Hebrew alphabet. There is no verse for the letter Nun. I'm sure I'm not pronouncing it correctly, but for some reason that verse is either missing or for some reason David chose not to use it. You'd sit back and say, man, why would David write the psalm that way? Well, remember that the psalms are poetry. They were poetry that were written for the purpose of being sung. And many times the psalmist would put those psalms in a poetic form that made it easier to memorize. And so as you're memorizing Psalm 145, if you were a Jewish man or you were a Jewish woman and you were memorizing that, and later on you were trying to recall those different psalms, it made it so much easier to realize that the first verse was written with the first letter and the second verse began with the second letter. It would help you in memorizing Scripture. Let me just pause for a second and say this. For some reason, memorizing Scripture has become a lost arts. Because we have the Bible at our fingertips all the time, and you have YouVersion on your Bible or on your phone, and I have YouVersion on my phone, we don't feel the need to have to memorize Scripture. And yet David said, your word have I hid in my heart. Why? So that I will not sin against God. So I would challenge you, as I'm challenging myself, to memorize Scripture. Now, what is the message that David is trying to convey in these verses? Let me mention today two very simple, yet two very profound principles that are found in these seven verses. The first principle is this. It's in your notes. Here's what David is saying. He's saying praise must be a priority. Would you say that with me today? Let's say that together. Ready? Praise must be a priority. Let's say it one more time. Praise must be a priority. Now, once again, I alluded to just a moment ago the title of the psalm. The psalm, not every psalm has a title, but this psalm is one of the psalms that has a title, and the psalm very, or the title very simply is this, a song of praise of David. And you might sit back and say, weren't all of David's psalms, weren't all 73 of David's psalms songs of praise? Well, the answer very simply is no, not all of them. David wrote some psalms that are called imprecatory psalms. Imprecatory psalms are psalms in which David was praying that God would judge his enemies. There's times where he basically says things like this, kick him in the mouth, God. He's praying these imprecatory psalms in which he wants God to judge and condemn his enemies. So not all of David's psalms were songs of praise. The majority of them, though, were. Evidently, though, this psalm was special to David. Some people believe that this psalm was David's favorite psalm. Why would that be? And obviously David's not here today, so we're jumping to a conclusion. But if Psalm 145 was David's favorite psalm, why in the world would it be his favorite psalm? And the answer very simply is this. It demonstrates the importance of praise. David understood the importance of praising God. As David was out in the sheep pastures tending the sheep, he what? He praised God. As David was running from Saul and he was hiding in the caves, even running for his life, David praised God. As David sat on the throne of Israel, judging and ruling Israel, he praised God. David realized and he understood the importance of praise. And here's what I believe David is sharing with us, that praise is vital to the believer. Praise is important for you. And praise is essential for me. It must be a part of our regular routine. As a matter of fact, I would say this, strong words. I would go so far to say that the professing believer who does not practice praise is either ignorant, ungrateful, or deceived. Let me say that again, because those are strong words. The believer who does not practice praise is either ignorant of the importance of it, ungrateful for all that God does and all who God is, or deceived into thinking that they do not need God. Now, what does David say today? What is it about praise that makes it so important for us? Two things that I want us to see. The first is this: praise demonstrates God's worth. Praise demonstrates God's value. Praise demonstrates that God and God alone is worthy. A believer who does not praise fails to recognize the greatness of God. The believer who does not praise fails to recognize the value of our relationship with Him. You see, whenever we praise Him, we are telling Him, "You are important." Whenever we praise Him, we are telling Him, "I need you. I am dependent upon you. You are of unbelievable value, immeasurable worth." Now, in today's passage, David says several things about God's worth, and we could teach a theology proper class in which for months we talk about the different characteristics of God. But David mentioned several in the chapter that I want us to see. The first thing he says is this. He says, God is preeminent, and He is worthy of our submission. God is preeminent. Notice in verse 1, not my words, David's words. David says, "I will extol you, my God and King." The word extol means to set preeminently on high, to exalt above all others. As a matter of fact, if you have a New Living Translation or you have an NIV Bible in your hands today, it says this: "I will exalt you." So David is saying, God, I want to exalt you. I want to extol you. I want to lift you up on high. I want to recognize your preeminence. The idea very simply being that God alone is preeminent. Now, if that word doesn't sink into you, let me say what that means in very simple terminology. It means that God is dominant. It means that God is superior to everyone and everything. He's at the top of the hill. He is on the throne. He is the owner. He's the chief. He's the boss. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. David says, God, you alone are preeminent. And as a result, I will extol you. I will exalt you. But notice, he also makes another very interesting statement. He says, I will extol you. And then how does he define God? My God and what? My King. The idea very simply being that because God is preeminent, He is worthy of our submission. He says, not only are you my God, but I recognize you as my King. I recognize you as my ruler. I recognize you as the one to whom I submit. You see, to recognize God as King means that you are obedient to His word and compliant to His will. Let me say that again. To recognize God as King, to recognize Him as preeminent, means that you are obedient to God's word and you are compliant to God's will. I want you to catch this, because this is so very important. Real worship is always followed by submission. Write that down. That was pretty good. All right? That was pretty good. Real worship is always followed by submission. I say that because there's a tendency in this day and age for people to go through the motions of worship. They raise their hands, they sing the songs, they cry out, they do all kinds of things, and then they walk out the door and they live the way that they want. And David is saying, no. Real worship not only recognizes who God is in His person, but real worship recognizes my position under Him. You see, the greatest obstacle to us truly worshiping God is not our not recognizing who He is. It's us not wanting to put ourselves in submission to Him. And so David says, "Oh my God, I exalt you, I extol you, and I recognize you as my God, as the King of my life." I would go so far as to say this: if your worship does not result in submission, then your worship is not sincere. If your worship does not result in submission, it's empty words. It's empty waving. Because real worship, from a biblical point of view, recognizes who God is, and I submit to His leadership in my life. Unfortunately, we live in a society that elevates man to the position of God. You see, in our society, here's what's taken place. Man has been promoted and God has been demoted. It's no longer about what God wants for me. It's about what I want for me. And whatever what I want for me clashes with what God wants for me, who gets shoved aside? God gets shoved aside. And so, in a very real sense, we have warped what worship truly is. Our standard of conduct is no longer what God says in His Word. Here's what David says: praise recognizes God's preeminence, and praise prods us to practice obedience. David says God is preeminent. As a result, He is worthy of my submission. Let me ask you today, have you come to a place in your life where you're willing to submit completely to God? And you're willing to submit completely to His Word? Whatever God wants me to do, I'm willing to do. It doesn't matter if it hurts. It doesn't matter whether it's painful. It doesn't matter whether other people agree or disagree. God, You are my King. I submit to You. David says a second thing. We could park there, but we don't have time. The second thing that David says is this: God is incomprehensible. He is worthy of our study. Now, notice verse 3. David says, "Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and His greatness is unsearchable." Here's what David is saying. David is saying that God is mysterious. God is profound. God is unfathomable. God is unintelligible. He is so far beyond our ability to comprehend that we will spend an entire lifetime trying to understand Him. And I would also say an entire eternity still learning who He is. If you sit back today and say, "I got God figured out," then you do not know God. Because in your finite mind, in my finite mind, it is impossible for the finite to understand the infinite. And we cannot completely understand Him. Not that we can't understand certain things about Him, but you and I will never get to the place where we say, "I got God completely figured out. I've learned everything there is to know about Him." By the way, there's two obstacles. This isn't in your notes. There are two obstacles that keep us from completely comprehending God. The first is our sin. Our sin. Our sin is the greatest obstacle, especially here on this earth, that keeps us from understanding God. But there's a second, because one day when we get to heaven, we no longer will be struggling with sin. But even during all of eternity, we're going to be learning about God. And what is the second obstacle that keeps us from understanding God? His greatness. Because He is so far beyond us. We could have millions of lifetimes and never exhaust everything there is to know about God. By the way, all that we know about Him is what He has chosen to reveal to us and His Word. And I would venture to say that there is so much more about God, even beyond what His Word tells us. And for all of eternity, you and I are going to have the privilege of learning about God. Psalm 147 and verse 5 says, "Great is our Lord and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure." Romans 11:33, "Oh, the depths of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and how inscrutable are his ways." I sat back and for 3 or 4 days I've tried to figure out how can I illustrate the incomprehensibility of God. How can I illustrate the complexity of God, that he is so far beyond us? I read illustration books. I read everything. I racked this, you know, this intelligent mind that I have, and I asked people. I couldn't come up with an illustration, and the two that I came up with seemed so insufficient. But imagine this. Imagine taking a little gnat and telling a little gnat, "I want you to go and drink all of the water from the Atlantic Ocean." How long would it take a gnat to drink all of the water from the Atlantic Ocean? If you're a scientist, please figure that out for me and tell me that later on. I would say millions and millions and millions and millions of years. Or how about you're a small ant standing at the bottom of Mount McKinley, with the task to climb all the way up to Mount McKinley. As a little ant, you'd sit back and say, "That is absolutely impossible. I could walk for millions of years and still not reach the summit." I would submit to you today that such is the incomprehensibility of God. God is so great. God is so awesome. He is so majestic that he is beyond our ability to know him. He's beyond our ability to completely comprehend. Here's what David said. David says, "He is worthy of our study." He's worthy of dedicating a lifetime to getting to know him. As I mentioned a few moments ago, the simple truth is that we only know what God has decided to tell us about him. So let me challenge you today. Let me challenge you. Devote your life to learning everything you possibly can about God. I was reminded as I read this of the words of Jeremiah in Jeremiah 9. "Thus says the Lord, let not the wise man boast in his wisdom. Let not the mighty man boast in his might. Let not the rich man boast in his riches. But let him who boasts, boast in this, that he knows and he understands me." What is the goal of your life? I'm reminded of the words of the Apostle Paul in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 10, as Paul wrote from a Roman jail and said, "Oh, that I may know him." David says, "God, your greatness is unsearchable. You're worthy of our study." He says a third thing. He says, "God is majestic. He is worthy of our worship." Verse 5, "Oh, the glorious splendor of your majesty, and on your wondrous works I will meditate." The word majesty has the idea of dignity, beauty, sovereignty, and royal power. Listen, I'm confident today that there's not a single one of us that have a right and correct understanding of God. You see, and by the way, God's here with us right now. Can't see him. I can't see him, but he's here. If all of a sudden, for just a brief moment, God decided to reveal himself to us. For some reason, on November 8th, 2015, at Hollywood Community Church, God said, "I'm going to reveal myself to the members of that church." And if God revealed himself as he is in all of his glory, you and I would fall on our face as if he were dead, as if we were dead. We wouldn't cry out, "Jesus, my buddy." We'd cry out like the Apostle John, who was the disciple that Jesus loved, who continually laid his head on Jesus' breast. And yet in Revelation, the beginning of Revelation, when he sees Jesus in all of his glory, he falls at the feet of Jesus as if he were dead. Our God is majestic. He's awesome. He's wonderful. There are no words in our vocabulary that can even begin to describe his greatness. He is worthy of our worship. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works, I will meditate. David says a fourth thing, and we could spend days studying each of these. The fourth thing he says, God is omnipotent. He's worthy of our admiration. I would add, he is worthy of our faith. The word omnipotent means all powerful. Verse 6 illustrates that divine quality. Verse 6, they will speak of the might of your awesome deeds and will declare your greatness. Let me ask you today, what has God done in your life? Thank you, sir. Best dressed man in the place gives me his handkerchief, huh? This is clean, by the way, right? Okay. Just wanna make sure. Doesn't hurt to ask. Doesn't hurt to ask, all right? What has God done in your life that demonstrates his omnipotence? What has God done in your life that demonstrates his power? See, I believe with all of my heart that God desires to demonstrate his power in our lives on a regular basis. And I believe that he does. We fail to see it. We're blinded by the problems and the struggles of life that we fail to see what God is doing in our midst. That's a perfect segue into our next point. Praise demonstrates God's worth. It demonstrates his value, but notice secondly, praise demonstrates man's wonder. It demonstrates man's wonder. You see, whenever we see the preeminence, the complexity, the majesty, and the omnipotence of God, our response should always be one of awe and wonder. It's like, some of you have been there, it's like riding on the Maid of the Mist at Niagara Falls and being down at the bottom of the falls and seeing thousands and thousands and thousands of gallons of water pour down to you at one moment. You sit back and you're what? You're in absolute awe. Oh, it's like riding a donkey down into the Grand Canyon. And you get to the bottom of the Grand Canyon or at the top of the Grand Canyon and you look at the magnitude of this and you were in absolute awe. It's like standing in Canada or in the Northern Hemisphere and looking up and seeing the dancing colors of the Northern Lights and being in absolute wonderment and awe of its beauty. You see, when you and I see God for who he really is, we respond with wonder. We respond with awe. Our natural response should be to praise him. You see, I sit back, I don't understand believers who don't want to praise God. I don't understand people who find it a drudgery to praise, because when we understand who he is, it drives us to praise him. David makes two points about our praise. First of all, he says this, your praise should be personal. Your praise should be personal. He says, I extol you, my God and King. Listen, here's the point. Nobody can praise God apart from a personal relationship with him. You cannot worship God in the abstract. You must know him. And the more you know him, the more you want to praise him. It's like your wife, guys. The more you know your wife, the more you love her. Right, guys? Right, guys? Turn to your wife and tell her that you love her, all right? Turn to your wife and tell her that you're amazed by her. Listen, the more you know God, the more you want to praise him. How cool is it to be able to say that God is my God? I mean, it's like when I'm out and I'm able to tell people, this is my wife. Man, the chest goes out. I mean, they might look at me, and I know the thought all the time. How could a guy as ugly as that get a lady as pretty as her? I know you've all thought about that, right? Hey, how cool is it to know that God, the creator of the universe. The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the one who's going to win at the end of the day. He's not just God. He's my God. He's my God. He's my friend. You see, praise is personal. And I'm so fearful that for many believers, it's not personal. It's worship, it's God, but we've failed to personalize worship. And as a result, it's not really real to us. David says the second thing, your praise should be continual. Continual, verse 1, I will bless your name forever and ever. Verse 2, I will praise your name forever and ever. Hey, here's what I want you to catch. Praise is not just a Sunday morning experience. Let me say it again. Praise is not just a Sunday morning exercise. Your Sunday morning worship is an expression of your daily worship. Your Sunday morning worship is an expression of your daily worship. It's like a football team going out and saying, hey, you know what? We're going to rest for 6 days and then all of a sudden go out and play football. You can't do it. You got to practice it. And the more you practice it, supposedly, the better you are, unless you're a football team from South Florida. For some reason, that doesn't really work that way, all right? All right? I don't get that, all right? Listen, Sunday morning should be a demonstration of what we have practiced all week long. Because on Monday, I praise God, and on Tuesday, I praise God, and on Wednesday, I praise God. And as I come together with God's people, it's just a demonstration. It's a public expression of everything that I've done in the quietness of my heart and in the quietness of my house. Your praise should be continual. For David, praise was something that was practiced continually in the sheep pasture, on the run from Saul, on the throne as king. He continually worshiped. One writer said this, our praise of God should be as eternal as the God we praise. Our praise of God should be as eternal as the God we praise. Is praise a priority in your life? Psalm 145, praise must be a priority. Let me show you the second thing, and I know I got just a few minutes, all right? The second thing, praise must be passed on. Praise must be passed on. Notice what David says in verse 4. One generation shall commend your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. It's interesting, and I don't want to parse all the verbs and diagram the sentence, but it's interesting to note that the first verb is singular. One generation shall commend, singular, your works to another and shall declare, the second verb is plural. Here's what David is demonstrating. He's demonstrating one generation begins to praise God and the next generation lifts their voice in unison with the previous generation and the next generation and the next generation and all of these generations coming together, all of them praising God together from one generation to another. Let me give you a couple of points. You must leave a legacy of praise. You must leave a legacy of praise. I'm often frustrated. Please, if I'm stepping on your toes today, I don't mean to. You know I love you. But I'm often frustrated when parents comment that they just can't keep their kids in church. Why would your kids be interested in doing something that you're not interested in doing? Why would your kids be interested in following through when you complain about getting up on Sunday morning and have to go to church? When praise does not impassion you, why would they be interested in something that does not truly interest you? You see, if your praise is not real, if you complain about coming to church and meeting together with God's people, if your children never see you with your Bible open, your children never see you on your knees before God, don't be surprised, mom and dad, if they drift away from God. And it hurts me to say that, but we're experiencing that in the church. It hurts me deeply that we are often more interested in getting our kids into other activities than we are getting them into the things of God. I know I stopped preaching and I'm meddling now. I know that. David says, one generation shall praise you, and the next generation shall declare your mighty works. Mom and Dad, you gotta leave a legacy of praise. You must leave a legacy of praise. How does that happen? David mentions two things. The first thing he says, leaving a legacy begins with quiet contemplation. Verse 5, on the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works, I will meditate. The word meditate means to engage in thought or contemplation, to think about it. David said this in Psalm 1, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law does he meditate day and night. Leaving a legacy begins with quiet contemplation, but leaving a legacy, secondly, results in a loud declaration. As a matter of fact, notice the verbs that David uses in the following verses. In verse 4, he says, I will commend. In verse 6, he says, I will speak. And then he says, I will declare. Verse 7, he says, I will pour forth. I will sing aloud. It's almost as if there is a crescendo. The message is getting louder and louder as we praise God. Our praise goes from quiet contemplation to the fact that we just can't keep it in. I must praise God. I'm reminded of Jeremiah 20 and verse 9. Jeremiah said, if I say I will not mention him or speak any more in his name, there is in my heart, as it were, a burning fire shut up in my bones, and I am weary with holding it in, and I cannot. You must leave a legacy of praise. Moms and dads, I would submit to you that the most important task that you have as parents is not to make sure that your kids get a great education. I think that's great. You should. Not to make sure that they enjoy all that this life has to offer. But your most important task, your God-given task, is to make sure that your kids become passionate followers of Jesus Christ who learn to praise him. You must leave a legacy of praise. Let me ask you this. The last thing I would say is this. You must examine your motives for praise. You must examine your motives for praise. So for the next 4 weeks, we're going to talk about praise. We're going to praise. By the way, you see these pictures up here that our creative team has done a great job, because we're going to praise God for the fact that he's worthy. We're going to praise God for the fact that he is gracious. We're going to praise God for the fact that he is generous. And we're going to praise God for the fact that he's a God who hears and answers our prayer. That's what we're going to be studying throughout Psalm 145. But as we begin this study, I'd like to ask you, what are your motives for praise? Why is it that you praise? I just asked two questions, and there's a multitude of questions that we would ask. Do you praise God more for what he does for you or for who he is? You said, Brian, what do you mean by that? Well, let's say that today the well dried up. Now, thank God he's promised to meet each and every one of our needs, and he does that graciously. But let's say all of a sudden it got tough, all right? The well dried up. The provision stops. The great health that you've had up to this point, you begin to suffer. And all of a sudden, the good things for which you have praised God in the past, where he has been overly gracious to you, for some reason, all of that changes. Are you still able to praise God? Are you able to praise God for who he is? I find it very interesting that many of the Psalms were written by David as he was in a cave, fleeing for his life, not certain what was going to happen. And in the midst of fear, in the midst of uncertainty, he cries out to God and praises God for his greatness. Can you praise God simply for who he is? Can you praise God during times of trouble as much as during times of triumph? God's so good to us. He gives us more than we could ever deserve. And many of our praises are praise God because he did this, and praise God because he supplied this, and praise God for this. Are you able to praise God during times of trouble as much as during times of triumph? What would happen in our country if all of a sudden we lost the freedoms that we hold so dear? And all of a sudden, like our brothers and sisters in China and our brothers and sisters in the Middle East, it became a dangerous thing to call yourself a Christian. And it became a dangerous thing to meet together with God's people. You lose your job. Your family ostracizes you. The government's looking for you. And all of a sudden, things become very difficult. Can you, with David, lift up your voice and say, "Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable. I'm amazed by his wondrous deeds and his awesome acts. God, I praise you for who you are." The simple truth is this: he is worthy of our praise. If he never gave us anything else for the rest of our lives, and he will, I'm not painting gloom, but if he never gave us anything else for the rest of our lives, we have received more than we could ever, ever, ever deserve from him. He's a great God, and he's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy to be praised. Praise must be a priority. Praise must be passed on. May God help us to be men and women of praise.